Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. The first item on our agenda today is an evidence session on the redress scheme, and can I welcome John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Gillian Nixon, the Head of Operations for the Redress Division, and Carol Lamont, Policy Lead Redress Division from the Scottish Government. Good morning. Oliver Mundell, MSP, is also attending committee today as he remains very interested in the work of Redress Scotland and how the redress scheme is working. Thank you for joining us today and a Happy New Year to you all. We'll begin with a short opening statement from the Deputy First Minister. Deputy First Minister, you have up to 3 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful for the opportunity to update the committee on the progress of Scotland's redress scheme now that it's completed its first full year of operation. The scheme is delivering tangible redress in the form of acknowledgement, payment, apology and support to those who suffered abuse as children in the care of the state. Scotland's redress scheme opened in December 2021. As of the 31st of December 2022, 1,960 applications of various levels of completion have been received. 345 initial applications have been completed, verified and passed to Redress Scotland for independent decision-making. 277 initial determinations have been made. Payments totalling £11,368,373 have been issued directly to applicants. Whilst these figures are heartening and demonstrate good progress, there is more work to be done and feedback from survivors and their representatives is continuing to shape the scheme. Redress payments are not dependent upon contributions from any organisation and organisations are not compelled to contribute. When the scheme launched, there were 10 organisations contributing to the scheme, and this figure is now 16, with potential contributions totalling £122 million. In December, I wrote to each applicant to reassure them of my ongoing personal commitment to the scheme and to reiterate the three principles of the scheme: compassion, dignity and respect. I understand that some applicants are experiencing challenges in accessing records to support their applications, and some are finding the process has taken longer than they had anticipated. These concerns have been heard and have been responded to. The number of caseworkers supporting survivors or their next of kin to complete applications has increased from 12 to 23 since the scheme launched in December 2021. This will mean swifter allocation of a named caseworker to those with completed applications which are ready for verification checks. I recognise the need for ongoing communication and have assured all applicants, no matter what stage of their application is at, that they will receive an update by the end of February and more regular communication going forward. The Survivor Forum, which was established in March 2022, will increase its activity and provide opportunities for survivors to provide feedback and further shape the scheme. A new group including representatives from the Scottish Government and local authority bodies has been established to work collaboratively to provide support to applicants to the scheme. A standing agenda item for the group is access to records and supporting information, and the group will be holding their second meeting in the coming weeks. Survivors have told us that the provision of personal acknowledgement and apology is often the most meaningful and important aspect of redress. So far, the scheme has supported 12 survivors who have requested personal apology, and this has already been secured for 10 of them. Feedback from survivors who have received an apology has been positive and moving. I welcome the ongoing interest from the committee and also more widely from members of Parliament across the chamber in the scheme. I'm confident that Scotland's redress scheme will continue to build upon its first successful year of operation, delivering a robust and credible route to redress in a swifter, less adversarial way than court action. But I am committed to ensuring that all the necessary steps to ensure the effectiveness of the scheme are taken and any improvements required are delivered. I'm very happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. And can we now move to members' questions and opening questions from Graham Day, please?
Thank you. Good morning, Deputy First Minister. The redress issue has had great sensitivity surrounding it all the way through. And I guess with a process such as this, there's sometimes a disconnect between the expectations some people hold about how it will work, how efficiently it will work, and what's reasonable to expect in the kind of initial phase. So I'm wondering, in a broad sense, Deputy First Minister, if you could give us a sense of how you feel the scheme has performed up till now, recognising that you've indicated that it's essentially still to be built upon and developed.
I think inevitably any new scheme takes time to find its feet and to find its effectiveness, its efficiency, its pace of working. So, you know, in the consideration of any range of applications in a scheme of this type, there will be literally, probably in every application, a new issue being uncovered, which has to be considered. It has to be related to the legislation. As colleagues will recall, the legislation is very complex on this scheme. It has to be, inevitably. So there are a variety of different considerations that will have to be made on literally every application. So I think it would be fair to say it will be slow to begin with, but the pace will be maintained. Now, one way of illustrating that, for example, which might help to address Mr. Day's question, is that if we look at March 2022, which was a couple of months after the scheme was operating, 26 applications were passed from the Scottish Government to redress Scotland for determination. That's completed applications to be judged for a redress payment. In November, that number was 66. So I hope that gives the committee some reassurance that the pace is being increased. And of course, that November figure predates the recruitment of essentially double the number of caseworkers. So what I would unreservedly accept is that any scheme of this type takes its time to find its momentum. What we have experienced is that more applications came in quicker than we had anticipated. The total number of applications is not adrift from our expectations. The shape in which they have come in is most definitely, and the state of development of those applications is variable. Some are very advanced, some are not very advanced. So that's taken a lot of time to support applicants to get to conclusions. But I do think we now have a growing sense of momentum within the scheme, which I'm very keen to build upon.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Can we move to questions now from Ross Greer, please? Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Deputy First Minister, you remember at stage three proceedings on the bill, Parliament agreed to my amendment for an 18-month review period in the scheme's initial period of operation. Could you talk us through what processes have been in place and are in place now to gather the evidence that that review will require?
Essentially, I think we've got a comprehensive data set that is emerging, some of which I've shared with the committee already, which in my opening statement, some of which is also reflected in the information I've just put on the record in response to Mr. Day's question. And there'll be other information, for example, about the number of cases that in which individuals will have requested a review of the determination by Redress Scotland and the outcome of some of those reviews. So in terms of data sets, I'm very confident there's a broad range of data that will be able to demonstrate satisfactorily the evidence base upon which a report can be constructed to address the substance of Mr. Greer's amendment that was passed at committee. But there is, of course, another very important dimension, probably as important dimension, if not more important dimension, which is what we hear from survivors through the survivor feedback. That is, of course, less quantifiable than the data that I've just talked about, but nonetheless very important for us to openly acknowledge what is the feedback from survivors, what is their experience, what do we need to do to try to address that as part of the operation of the scheme. So I think the data and the information is there. I suppose what I would say to the committee is that if the committee wishes to It's all very well Parliament passing an amendment which says there shall be a review. The committee may wish to give me some input about what it would like to see covered within the review, and I'd be very happy to consider that as to ensure that what we actually produce in that review addresses the points that are on the mind of the committee. So if the committee wished to give me, in the light of this session, some expectation about what it would like to see in there, I'd be very happy to do my best to address that.
We can certainly do that as a committee. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a very welcoming invitation. Thank you. You'll remember that by far the most controversial and difficult element of the proposals in the bill and what's operating in the scheme was the waiver, something that we all struggled with, and a number of us came to very different positions on, despite complete consensus around the broad principles of this. Could you talk a little bit about the specific arrangements that are in place to make sure that the review will be able to report on the impact that the waiver has had? That was the primary purpose of the amendment, was to make sure that we could assess the impact of the waiver.
Yeah, well, we will be gathering that information from our dialogue with survivors, and that's a broader dialogue than just in relation to the Redress Scotland process, if I can call it that. Because, of course, part of the discussion about the waiver is that there will be a group of people who decide, because of the presence of the waiver, this scheme is not for them. And therefore, we have to be, I think, for us to provide as complete a picture as we can, we have to be cognizant of what those who are looking at the scheme and coming to the conclusion that the scheme is not for them because, for example, of the presence of the waiver, are considering about the scheme, and then ultimately formulating a position that reflects all of that information. There will, of course, within the scheme, be applicants who will consider whether or not it is appropriate for them to sign the waiver once they see the proposition that is coming to them from Redress Scotland. And that information is important for us to gather and to reflect in the progress report that we undertake.
Without wishing to preempt the report, given that there's been very consistent ongoing dialogue with survivors, do you have any indication so far of what the impact has been? Has there been feedback of a particular trend so far?
I think, given that we've completed and passed to Redress Scotland 345 applications, I think it's quite difficult at this stage to draw out patterns of opinions in that respect. In relation to, there have been 277 redress determinations made by Redress Scotland. 255 applicants have already made a decision to accept. Now, obviously, there are 6 months. There's a period of 6 months given to an applicant to consider whether they wish to accept the application. So there is there's 22 cases in that data who haven't yet decided to accept the offer. So they will be considering. I'm making an assumption that they will be considering whether it's appropriate, and I would imagine the waiver will be part of that consideration. But given the interest in these questions, I will endeavour to provide in the 18-month report as much detail as we can about the attitudes and views about the waiver and its significance. But I think that data that I've shared, 277 redress determinations made by Redress Scotland, 255 applications or offers accepted, I hope reassures the committee that the overwhelming majority of applicants are seeing the proposition that is coming to them as something that they are prepared to accept. Now, I appreciate I'm making an assumption based on that data. I think we'd probably have to interrogate views and attitudes from applicants to conclude on that position.
Yeah, the very last point I would make on that would just be to ask you, as part of that review process, to ensure that the views of survivors who've chosen not to even begin the application process are taken into account, because we can assume, based on the feedback, the evidence we took in the first place, that for a number of those who decide not to even embark on this process, it may well be because the waiver's in place.
I am certain that is the case, and I would give the committee the assurance that through the dialogue that we have with survivors, that is an issue that we will explore. I have been talking to a particular survivor myself, who I know has been very helpful in informing our approach in many respects, but I know has a very difficult dilemma to wrestle with as to whether or not the scheme is correct for them, given the presence of the waiver. And so I can think of one example myself where that is a very big consideration for that individual, and they are making an outstanding contribution to our thinking and our development. They could not be more helpful, but at a personal level, the waiver is an issue for them. So I acknowledge that.
I've got one final question.
Okay, that's fine, Ross. Yes,
thanks. The core purpose of the waiver and the proposition that was put to us for why the waiver was necessary in the first place was to ensure that certain organisations made a contribution to the scheme, that they were willing to participate. Have those organisations done so to a satisfactory extent?
I think broadly the level of contribution by external organisations is positive. I think it would be fair to... I said in my opening remarks that...
Sorry to cut across you, Deputy First Minister, just because I'm conscious of time. Specifically, though, the organisations who were clear that they weren't going to contribute unless there was a waiver in place. We heard from... In fact, the organisations were most vocal, who were prepared to come to the committee and put their views on record, were generally organisations who were not fixed on the waiver being necessary, whereas the organisations who... in a way that was significantly problematic for parliamentary scrutiny, did not appear in front of the committee, did not put their views on the record, were quite clear off the record that they wouldn't contribute without the waiver in place. Have those organisations contributed?
I think from the list that I have, and the list is published on the government's website, so I think I'm a wee bit of a disadvantage that I don't quite know specifically to whom Mr. Greer refers, but I suppose if it's I'd be happy to pursue this issue subsequently. But the list is available on the government's website, and I feel that we have a reasonable level of participation from external organisations. But I think that's I acknowledge the sensitivity of this matter and the concern. So I think it's perhaps for a broader range of people to judge whether my view is appropriate or rather than just mine.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister, for managing that so delicately at the end there. Can we move now on to questions from Vice Convener Kochab Stewart, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Deputy First Minister.
Good morning.
I just wanted to thank you for the update on the caseworker recruitment and just sort of look into that a little bit. And you also acknowledge that more work does need to continue to be done there. I have a constituent and a case that I've been following that has, I suppose, experienced the bit where they felt that there was a lack of caseworkers and they weren't allocated. However, the situation has moved on from them, and that seems to mirror in what you've said about the recruitment of the 23 caseworkers. So is this going to be maintained, that level of caseworker, throughout the operation of the redress scheme? And is there any sort of like wiggle room there that, because obviously the cases are very complex, so if there's a requirement that more caseworkers need to be done or other people need to be brought in, that would be good to hear.
Yeah. The position we started off in the original plan was to recruit 12 caseworkers, which we did, and the team was constructed on that basis. It became very clear to us quite quickly that that was not going to be sufficient given the shape of applications that had come in. So therefore, we took the decision to expand the number of caseworkers. Now, I don't think it's a secret that it's quite difficult to expand civil service employment just now. There is not, you know, it's not really flavour of the month to do that. So therefore, it's the decision to essentially double the number of caseworkers should be considered within the context of the recruitment constraints under which we are operating just now. And that's an indication of the fact that we recognise this scheme had to be more substantively resourced than it was to begin with. What I would say is that I think we'll obviously begin to see in the first months of this year the effect of the new caseworkers coming in. So the numbers that I shared with Mr. Day of essentially going from 26 a month in February to 66 a month of applications being passed to Redress Scotland, I would expect to see that number grow, and I will be monitoring the progress of that number, because that will be an indication of the effect of the caseworkers in processing more cases. But I am anxious that people are not waiting longer than is necessary for a determination, because people have suffered enough. The last thing they should be doing is waiting a long time for determination here. So if we need to expand that number further, we will do so. The one thing I would say, though, is that it's not a straightforward recruitment exercise to recruit caseworkers for this particular task, because not everybody is suited to do this work. And this work is very taxing on individuals, emotionally and psychologically. Staff have to be substantively... They have to come to the job with a very deep sense of commitment to the task. It is a difficult task. They have to be trained to be able to have the necessary resilience to deal with that. They have to be... we have to be satisfied that they can appropriately deal with trauma and be appropriately trauma trained. That is not a straightforward process. So the recruitment process does of itself take some time, and we have to be very satisfied that we have people who can deploy the right approach in the handling of these applications. So whilst I am leaving the door very much open to continued expansion, I do put in the caveat that we have to be satisfied that the necessary recruitment and training approaches are in place. So we can't just, you know, with in no way being disrespectful, we can't just go to a temping agency and say, send us another 10 people. That would be totally counterproductive. So I suppose I put that on the record to seek a bit of understanding from the committee that we have to take a lot of care about the recruitment of those individuals.
Yeah, I think that is absolutely noted. I mean, certainly for us that are having constituents that we're dealing with, you know, we're aware of one layer of the complexity and the sensitivities around it. So I can't imagine for caseworkers the challenge of that very professional job. And it's important to put that acknowledgement of their work on record as well. Yeah. You mentioned that people have been waiting a long time. So is there any priority? I mean, obviously, every case is very individual and, you know, it all deserves the same priority. But there will be people for either medical reasons or other reasons that priority, you know, has that been considered?
We are prioritising applications from people who have a terminal illness and those who are aged over the age of 68. So those two factors, and those were the two factors we utilised in the advance payment scheme that we put in place in advance of Redress Scotland, when we used the general powers available to government to put in place a temporary scheme. So those were the criteria we used there, and we are continuing to apply these. What we have also done is we have started a process of calling individuals, although they may not have been allocated a caseworker, but calling individuals to basically say, we have your application and it is, you know, it's in the process of being looked at, and to give individuals a contact, which was not in place at the beginning, and that we recognised that was a gap. So therefore, people submitted their application and then it was a bit of a vacuum. So we've put in that call. So people get that call within 6 weeks of the application being submitted, so that they know it's recognised, it is being it's part of the process, but it may be some time before we get to that application. But as I say, I do believe we now have more momentum within the system, and we are yet to get the fruits of the recruitment of the additional caseworkers.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
And Bob Dorris has a supplementary on this topic.
Just a very brief supplementary. Convener, Deputy First Minister, it was welcome to hear, I think, in the answers to Graham Day and the Deputy Convener, that we've went from 26 applications each month been considered to 66, and that may go up further as with these new initial caseworkers. But of course, that's throughput. I hate that expression, throughput, but that is, if you like. But the individual experience is the length of wait for each individual, of course. So I'm just wondering, what's the average length of wait for someone to have a determination made currently, and what would you anticipate the average length of wait becoming as these new caseworkers get fully up to speed? Because that will allow us to monitor the individual experience rather than the amount going through the system, which I think would be quite helpful for the committee.
Yeah, it's difficult for me to give a specific answer on that point, because the applications are so individual and come in at such different stages of development. So some applications can come in with really quite a lot of information and evidence, and they can really be processed quite quickly and passed to Redress Scotland. Once an application goes to Redress Scotland, I think generally the process time for determination by Redress Scotland, I think, is of the order of 21 days. Once it goes, but it's very difficult to give a figure for the prior stages to that, because the evidence base, the quality of the application will vary to such a significant extent, and caseworkers may well be actively involved with an applicant in trying to source additional information. So an individual may submit an application, they may be allocated a caseworker, and the caseworker may be working with them to try to develop the sufficient evidence base to make the application as strong as possible. So that will influence the amount of time that is deployed and what is the turnaround time on individual applications.
Deputy First Minister, I suppose we'll just check, I accept all of that, it's such individualised cases, but is there any way at all some of that could be monitored? Because I absolutely accept each individual case has to be looked at empathetically at different stages when the initial application is made, but it would still be good to have some form of monitoring of the efficacy of that casework handling system for those individuals as they go through that system. And I know that raw data might not have a relevance, but is there a way you'll keep that under scrutiny anyway?
Let me take that point away, and I'll see if there's any more information I can shed in the light of this evidence session. But if there is, recognising that's an important issue for the committee, if there's anything we can further develop to support that and to answer that, I'll certainly look at that.
Thanks for that commitment, Deputy First Minister. Can I now move to questions from Stephen Kerr, please?
Yeah, so thank you, Deputy First Minister, for the way in which you are dealing with all of this. You mentioned your letter that you sent on the anniversary of the first year of the scheme, and I think you probably got quite a bit of feedback, I imagine, from those that you wrote to. One of the people that received your letter said that they felt it was tone deaf. They felt that the deliberations were taking so long that most of the people will be dead before they are considered. Now, that's obviously a very emotional response from a survivor. And I've heard very clearly that you put down the delay in terms of the length of the process to the nature of the applications and the capacity that you've described. There was a problem with the capacity to process the applications. You mention, am I right in saying that? Is that the summary, basically, of why it's taking so long?
I think there's three factors that are involved. First of all, that although the total volume of applications has not surprised us, the volume coming in so early was counter to our expectations. That was related to the second point, which is those applications were coming in at variable stages of development. So some were very advanced, some were not very advanced at all in terms of evidence. And we would be serving nobody's interests by sending an ill-developed application to Redress Scotland because it would stand a chance of being rejected. And then thirdly, we started off with 12 caseworkers and we judged that that was not sufficient, so we've taken the action to essentially double that number.
So just to confirm, you started off with 12 in place?
Yes, we did, yes.
And how many are there now?
23.
There are now 23.
There
so
are
the,
23.
The intention to recruit has been fulfilled?
It's done, yes, sir. Yeah.
Right, okay, that's
yeah, they were recruited and completed the recruitment process probably in November?
November.
And your commitment is, if necessary, to expand that?
We'll keep that under review, but I'm confident that we're already seeing, even with the numbers that I shared in response to Mr. Day's question, were numbers for November when none of the new caseworkers were contributing because they were still being recruited, and some were in training. Quite a lot of that training was also going on in December. So we'll only now really, in January, be beginning to feel the benefit of the 23 caseworkers. But so the numbers I put on the record in response to Mr. Day of going from sort of 26 to 66 a month are numbers I would expect to increase in the coming months.
And can I ask you, are you satisfied as the minister responsible that the applicants are getting the right level of support they need at all of the stages of their applications?
Yes, I am, but I do acknowledge that people will be frustrated by the time it will take because we've got a backlog to work our way through. But again, to go back to the point I responded to the deputy convener, we can't just, if we sometimes have a sort of routine application process, we can throw temporary resources at that to administratively process information.
Yeah.
That can't be done here.
It's
too sensitive. It's too complex. Yeah. It's too disrespectful, frankly, to do that. So I feel as if we have a robust scheme that's well-resourced, but I do acknowledge there will be frustration at the length of time it is taking. But to go back to the point, again, that I responded to the deputy convener, and this is contained in one of the points that Mr. Kerr puts to me from the correspondent that has responded to my letter, that we are prioritising those with a terminal illness. We are prioritising older applicants, and we are working through the applications as systematically as we can.
I appreciate the way that you're responding to the voice, as it were, of the survivor. And it's important that their voice is heard in the proceedings of this committee. Another survivor said, in relation to this issue of support, it's not acceptable for survivors to have to keep reliving their trauma because a public body can't get their skates on and fix things. It's a reflection of the frustration that you described.
There's a difficulty there because inevitably in this scheme we will need survivors to recount what has happened. That is unavoidable. It's inescapable in this scheme. Now that will come at a particular moment in the handling of the application, and that's why we have to have the right people to be able to handle that process and to do it properly with applicants. So there is, regrettably, an inevitability about some of that because of the nature of the scheme. We're trying to address things that should never have happened in people's lives. So that will be traumatic and painful. We try to do that to the minimum level possible, but it's an inevitable part of the scheme, unfortunately. Yep.
One last point from me, which is around, we had a discussion earlier from Ross Greer about the waiver scheme and organisational contributions. Very difficult, of course, as was acknowledged in the last session when this legislation was going through process, to work out what the potential cost of this would be. Now, a year down the run, are you in any better position to estimate where we are in relation to the original estimations of the costs that might come with this?
I think it's a developing picture. I put on the record that we have made redress payments of just short of £11.4 million. And we will just need to see the way in which that develops. I think the data is there to be monitored against what our expectations were. But I think this is a scheme where I think it is, I think I acknowledged this when we were looking at the financial memorandum on this bill, that it was not one that we could be absolutely certain about, but we were giving it our best attempt to try to provide an evidence base based on international experience. But we live in Scotland; it'll be what it'll be in relation to the applicants that come forward. I think it would be appropriate and important that I continue to inform the committee on an ongoing basis about the development of payments here as a matter of public record. And if the committee wishes to reflect to me what information it would want to see on a regular basis, I'll happily supply that in letters to the convener, which will give the committee an update on that information or any other information which is relevant to the committee's deliberations.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can we move to questions now from Stephanie Callaghan?
Thank you, Convener. Just come back, you've touched already after Stephen's question there on the trauma that people are going through when they're writing their statements. And we've seen the media coverage where survivors have spoken about the time and the upset that writing a fresh statement causes them when they've been prevented from using a statement that they submitted previously to other inquiries. Can I ask you to comment on what the kind of reasoning is behind them having to write a fresh statement and any steps that can be taken to minimise that re-trauma and that re-traumatising impact on the applicants?
This is quite a delicate matter for me to handle, because the decision to which Stephanie Callaghan refers is as a consequence of a restriction order issued by Lady Smith as chair of the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, in which the order prevents applicants from using their inquiry statement as part of their application unless the applicant has waived their anonymity at the inquiry and the statement has been published by the inquiry. Now, that's a decision for the inquiry and by Lady Smith. I have made representations to try to seek a different view, but I have been unsuccessful in seeking an alternative approach. So it's, and obviously, as the committee will appreciate, the Child Abuse Inquiry operates independently of government, so I have to respect the conclusion that has been arrived at by Lady Smith in applying a restriction order, which is perfectly within her powers to do so.
Okay. So is there anything particular then that you would say to the applicants themselves who are feeling re-traumatised by this? Are there any steps that we can take, any further steps that we can be taken to offer support in that area?
What I would say is, firstly, to reassure applicants that we have tried to secure an alternative approach, but that we have been unsuccessful. I would apologise to them for the fact that they are having to go through a similar process, but seek their understanding that we need to have that information to enable us to ensure they have the strongest possible case to be put to Redress Scotland, and that it's within that context that our caseworkers will sensitively work with them to ensure that that is produced.
Thank you, and I do appreciate the sensitivity, and it's good to have that on the record. Kind of on a similar vein, I suppose, as well, really welcome the Survivors Forum that's been established to engage with all the applicants to gather their feedback. Is there flexibility for that feedback to be considered quickly enough to make some real practical improvements to the process? Where that would be helpful?
Yes, we're listening to survivors' feedback all the time, and we're, you know, an operational level, changing processes, adapting processes to ensure that that is reflected. I think there's an environment of constant learning within the team who are working on this activity to ensure that we are absorbing, hearing and absorbing and applying the feedback from survivors on an ongoing basis. It's a very welcome part of the process that we are undertaking.
Okay, thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Stephanie. Can we move now to some questions from Michael Mara, please?
Thank you, Convener, and welcome, Deputy First Minister. I want to ask some questions around Ferneithy House. I know it's a situation, a case that you're very aware of and have taken an active interest in. And it relates to young girls who were sent from Glasgow by Glasgow Corporation over a period of decades to Ferneithy House in Angus, and many of whom seem to suffer systemic and horrific abuse. And I know there's much more detail to come out about those issues. But there, you will be aware, I believe, that the Petitions Committee have written to you this week in relation to Petition 1933, titled Allow the Ferneithy Survivors to Access Scotland's Redress Scheme. Excuse me. So that committee is clear that the state had responsibility acted to send these girls to Ferneithy House, and that's based on the evidence that they received as a committee. So I'd just like to get your reflections in terms of the eligibility for those women as survivors to access the redress scheme.
I'm grateful to Mr. Mara for raising this question, because I think it is a timely opportunity to reflect on this. And I'd like to address his question, if you forgive me, Convener, this may well take me some time, in two parts. The first is the situation as we face today, and then the second will be what is my thinking in the light of the Petitions Committee letter to me. The situation today is that, and I've listened carefully to the group who have made representations to me all of whom are Ferneithy survivors and are part of the wider group, that I do not believe there is inherently an impediment to applications coming forward from people who spent time at Ferneithy within this scheme, as things currently stand. Because I do acknowledge that the nature of the environment in which individuals were spending time at Ferneithy could be considered as falling within the ambit of this scheme. So I don't think there is an inherent impediment to applications coming forward and being considered. So the idea, if I can put it slightly more bluntly, that this scheme is not for Ferneithy survivors, I reject that view. I think it is possible for Ferneithy survivors to be successful in this scheme. That brings me on to my second point, which is where am I in relation to the Public Petitions Committee a letter. And as Mr. Mara correctly says, I received this letter just this week from the convener of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee. And in that letter, I think there's a really key point that Jackson Carlow makes to me, which is, and I quote, The committee heard that parental responsibilities were transferred to local authorities, such as the then Glasgow Corporation. Temporarily in these cases, the local authority could be considered to be acting, quotes, in loco parentis, close quotes, when providing short-term respite and holiday care. Now, that, I think, is the key point. Because, essentially, the scheme we Parliament legislated for provides redress because of the obligation of the state to ensure proper care was provided to individuals when they were in an in-care situation as the responsibility of the state. If a young person was at a holiday camp and they were dropped off by their parents and picked up by their parents, I think it's difficult to judge. I think it's difficult to say, to substantiate that the state was exercising that responsibility. The situation at Ferneithy, however, I don't think ticks that rather, if I may say so, neat middle-class box that I've just outlined to the committee. The more I understand about the situation at Ferneithy, the more I find it difficult to reconcile Ferneithy with some form of a voluntary endeavour. So I think it's on that point that it hinges. So that's a long way, convener, forgive me for the length of time I've taken. It's a long way of me saying I'm going to reflect carefully on the letter that I've had from the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee. I gave the ladies that came to see me the assurance that I would look carefully at this issue. I've said publicly that I don't think there's an impediment to their cases being considered by the redress scheme. If there is something more explicit that I need to do, I am certainly considering whether there is a case for doing that based on what I think would be fair to say is an emerging picture of where the circumstances in which people found themselves at Ferneithy.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I think it's a significant evolution given the evidence that you've taken and the conversations you've had with the survivors. Certainly, I think moving on from the submission you made to the committee on the 8th of September, I think the language that you're using is very sympathetic in that regard, and I recognise you'll want to consider the matter more fully in response to that committee. I mean, Caroline Harris, one of the survivors, has said that the council put us at risk by sending us there. They were sent there by the council. Why haven't they acknowledged this? So it's partly, as you set out at the start of the committee, looking for acknowledgement, understanding that there is a responsibility and that they were put in that situation. They go on to, Violet Wilson says to a child, 6 weeks feels like a year. You know, so the idea of a short-term stay to them, you know, abuse is abuse, Carol White. They're absolutely clear that what they suffered and that there should be the opportunity for them to access it. Can I ask specifically whether, to your knowledge, have any Ferneithy survivors applied and been processed and been accepted through the scheme?
I don't know the answer to the question, and I don't know if I could answer that question. I can't answer that question because I most definitely don't have detailed knowledge of any application. And I'm not actually sure I could ask anyone. If you get my, and I'm not being difficult. It's just I think we have to be awful careful about the personal data issues involved here. So I'm actually not sure, but there is a deeper question,
yes,
that underpins Mr. Mara's question, or a deeper point that underpins Mr. Mara's question, which is, is there a route for such a process to happen? I think there is, which is the reassurance I've given to the group that have come to see me, because I think if I listen to some of the quotes that Mr. Mara has given to me today, I can, and it relates to that key paragraph I read out from Jackson Carlaw's letter to me, I can understand why people think, well, the state was all over this. And what it's an interesting and disturbing conversation to have with Fornethy survivors to work out why they were there.
Yeah.
And I'm struggling with that. I'm really struggling with that point, because if I listen to their stories, I can't fathom it.
Yeah.
So as a consequence, that's why I say I think this scheme is perfectly open to Fornethy survivors, but I just have to satisfy myself, and I don't think I satisfy myself by being able to answer the question that Mr. Mara has put to me, which is, has a survivor been successful? Because I don't think I'll ever know that the answer to that question unless a Fornethy survivor tells me.
Yeah, I think that's more than fair. Can I ask then, in terms of the reflections you've made, should Glasgow City Council, as a successor organisation, be acknowledging these women?
I think at this stage, I would say that all public organisations have to be open and candid about things in the past. That's why the government established the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, because we came to the conclusion that despite a number of very welcome, well thought through approaches to try to address the deep trauma and hurt and agony of individuals, we hadn't done that successfully without actually airing the truth about all of this. Now, the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry is generating material that is unfathomable. It's in some cases, and I readily admit this, I find unreadable. And some parts of it I literally cannot read. So it's part of the country facing up to its past and its obligations. And that is incredibly difficult. So I would say to any organisation in the country, this is not a moment to be anything other than candid.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Thank you, Gabriel.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. And can we move to questions now from Willie Rennie, please?
I think we all appreciate the sensitive way that you've just addressed that issue. I mean, I've met many of the Fornethy survivors, and you can tell it's deeply affected their whole life. And I think they will appreciate, as I'm sure everybody here, the way that you've tried to navigate through the difficult legal territory. So I hope that we can find a resolution to that, because I think those women do deserve justice and fairness. I want to kind of draw on the kind of your wider reflections of this whole process of redress, because it's not just the financial transaction. It's not just an application process. People are opening up to you. They're telling you all of their experiences, just like the Child Abuse Inquiry has had. But anybody that they open up to, particularly a government, has got a responsibility, a duty, to take that information and treat it with care. So it's about the human being as much as it is about the finance. And I'm just wondering, now that you're several months into this process, I wonder what your reflections are of that and how you've been able to help and assist and aid those individuals. I know there's many organisations out there that are doing the same, but they've opened up to you. And I'm just wondering what you've learnt from it, what you've reflected upon, and whether you think the system that we have in place to carry them with care is sufficient, if ever it can be sufficient.
I think it's important in answering Mr. Rennie's question to reflect the fact, and I think which is inherent in the way in which he's formed that question, that there are a number of elements to this. It's not just about a financial redress decision. I had a conversation which will never leave me with the advisors who work with Future Pathways, and these are people who are allocated to support survivors of abuse and to find the predates the redress scheme, to try to support people who've been the victims of historic childhood sexual abuse. And I asked them, well, how do you go about it? And one of them said to me, we walk alongside the individual. And I just thought, well, what more do you need to know? They are probably the first reliable, trusted ally that person has had in their life. So I've taken that, I'll never forget that conversation, and it's gone into the thinking behind this scheme. Because in all my experience in all of this area of policy, which is quite unfamiliar to me, I had when all this sort of kicked off 20 years ago, when these issues were raised by Marlon Livingston in the cross-party group 24 years ago when this parliament was founded, I kind of thought, historic childhood sexual abuse? Well, what? But of course, we now know so much more. That was my experience as a child, but of course, we now know so much more as a society. So this has opened up a lot of things. I've learned a lot in this. So that concept of we walk alongside people has never left me. So this scheme has been designed so that when we're working with people, we're walking alongside them to try and help them to a conclusion. So that's the thinking. So that's one big thing that I've learned out of all of this process. One of the other things that struck me, one of the caseworkers was telling me that they had I mentioned in my contribution that there had been a number of requests for a written apology, which is part of the scheme. So it's not about money, it's a written apology. And one survivor asked for and got that. And they phoned up and asked their caseworker if they would mind reading it over the phone to them, because they wanted to have it read to them by the state. Okay. And the caseworker told me it was a profoundly moving encounter, because in a sense they felt they were reading, they were conveying to that individual the apology of the state. I've stood up down in Parliament through the corridor there, I've stood up there and I've given an apology on behalf of the government, which I know is valued by survivors, but here's an applicant asking for just a couple of minutes of someone's time to read over the phone the apology from the state. And I think I don't know the individual involved, but I would hazard a guess that that's more important than the cheque. Yeah. At least one survivor has asked the First Minister to write to them, and we have arranged for that to be the case, and that letter has been sent from the First Minister, signed at her own hand, and that's what an individual asked for, and we've facilitated that. So I think Mr. Rennie is right to highlight that this is a broader consideration than it's very easy, you know. There's a wee bit of me is in my usual mode of evidence-based transactional data, but there's an awful lot more to it than that.
Thank you for that, Deputy First Minister. Just catch my breath a little bit. It's now over to questions from Oliver Mundell, please.
Thank you, Convener. I mean to say up front, I recognise absolutely your personal commitment to getting this scheme through in the last Parliament. And I know that there was some time pressure in terms of making sure that the work didn't go to waste, but I feel in terms of some of the issues around the delays and the challenges in processing the application, I felt kind of would be right to just press you on the modelling and how we modelled for 12. And you mentioned in the course of today three factors in the delays and all the bits, and I think there is a fourth for which I think we're, as a Parliament, collectively responsible as well in terms of expectation management as well. I think people, survivors, you know, rightly, in terms of these applications coming in and the principles we set out, kind of thought things might move a bit quicker than they have. And again, I think it's our, you know, we always have to be cautious of that. But in terms of the modelling, where did the kind of idea that people would take longer to put in their applications come from? And we've looked at comparator schemes elsewhere, you know, as part of drawing up this legislation. Sort of where did that? How did we get the modelling wrong, basically?
I think if we look at the advance payment scheme, the advance payment scheme was actually handled pretty swiftly, pretty timorously, pretty straightforwardly. But of course, there's a big difference between the advance payment scheme and this scheme. The advance payment scheme was a much lower bar of evidence and process than is involved in a fully legislated for scheme. So I think in that respect, you know, Mr. Mundell, I think, puts his finger on a fair point, which is that I think we probably conveyed the impression that this was just a continuation of the swiftness of the advance payment scheme when it was not. When it was, what we were legislating for was something more complex and demanding. So I think that is one factor. The other is that I think I don't say this in any way to try to, I hope in the course of this session I've been as candid as I set out to be when I came in the room this morning. I don't think the applications that came in, when I say they came in with varying degrees of evidence, some were coming in with literally a name and an address, and I was in care at X, and others were coming in with a folder of stuff and all the evidence marshalled and all the rest of it. Now, those two applications need significantly different time and attention. So although we've got a number of applications that require a lot of development work, I'm not sure I could describe them as an application. They're almost a pre-application. And I don't want to say that in any way disrespectfully to what has come in, but I'm trying to give colleagues a sense that there was a lot of development work. So although we've got...
Mr. Doris's point earlier, because I mean, I'm certainly aware there are some applications that have gone in very early after the scheme opened that still haven't moved forward, and I guess they probably fall into that category.
They talk about
where effectively there's people who've been there on day one wanting to make sure that they didn't they didn't miss out on the
But on that point, can I reassure Mr. Mundell and any constituents he may be speaking on behalf of, is that nobody's going to miss out.
Okay.
Nobody is going to miss out. So the scheme is time limited, yes, but I put on the record during the passage of the scheme that it will not be closed prematurely. Nobody's going to miss out. If there's a proper application to be determined, I give the assurance that will be determined. It may take longer than people anticipate, but we've put some prioritisation into this of the terminal illness and the older applicants. Although I'm very conscious that even younger people who have experienced childhood abuse, their longevity will be affected by their experience. So I can't I can't kind of comfort myself by thinking, well, it's, you know, we are addressing all of that vulnerability. I appreciate that vulnerability is real and present for many other applicants.
I think those are both two helpful points to make. I think they will be appreciated, because I think, again, when we talk about terminal illness, I think there are a number of individuals who have life-limiting serious health problems, who feel slightly frustrated, I guess, that others they want others to be successful, and they're not seeing themselves as wanting to slow down things for other people who are in difficult circumstances too. But I think there's a frustration when they hear terminal illness, that there are a group of people who fall just short of that medical description, but who feel time for them is running out.
Let me take that issue away, and if the committee wishes to write to me with further thoughts about what those considerations may be, then we can consider that, because I'm not closed in my mind to adding to means of applying some prioritisation to consider the applicants if there are circumstances such as those that Mr Mundell puts to me.
Thank you. Again, I think that will be appreciated. The other thing I wanted to ask about was the appeals process. You set out the figures before where you said there was 277 applications, 255 had accepted. And certainly from the information Spice had provided, they thought there was 15, but off a lesser number, a less up-to-date number, they thought that 15 people had requested an appeal. Are they included in that 22, or is the 22 people who have, when you say people haven't made a determination whether to accept, is that people in the review process, or is that something different?
No, the 22 of the gap between Redress Scotland determinations and acceptances will be people who are considering their offers that have been made. There have been 19 review cases. Four of those remain in progress and have not yet had an outcome. Three review requests have resulted in the initial determination being upheld, and 12 review requests have had the initial determination varied, which means that the payment offer of financial redress has been increased.
And why, again, that's helpful information, why do you think, 12, we're dealing with quite a small number. As feedback I have had from one individual, it's just this feeling that somehow other, if you go back for the review, you could be getting more help to gather more information. And some of these people who have seen an increased payment, have spent more time looking at their application, and that's sort of brought new information to light. And I know that the system's under pressure. That's kind of why I ask.
I don't know the answer to whether or not, and this is an issue which is within Redress Scotland, it's not something on what I would call the government side of this, because Redress Scotland is making these determinations at arm's length from government. I'm not sure if that process will involve the ability to gather new information.
It's verifying or looking again, obviously in the process of verifying or looking again at the information that's there.
It's no new information.
But they can piece together things differently.
Carlo, Gillian.
So I think it's important to highlight that a review is open to all applicants of the scheme at the point that a determination is made. And there is the opportunity to have a fresh panel look at that. But there is also the opportunity, if the applicant wishes to provide further information that they didn't have at the point that it first went to the panel, if for any reason, it can be submitted. Or if if there's anything in response to the initial determination that they think, they wish the panel to look at again, they have the opportunity to put in as part of their review application anything in particular they wish to be looked at.
So, I guess the question, are you satisfied? When we're seeing, a number of people come back and getting an increased payment after their application has been looked at again, and it's maybe a wee bit higher, than you might sort of hope or expect. I mean, I know it's a new scheme and it's a sensitive issue, but it just struck me, you know, that it's a wee bit higher than you might have hoped.
I'm now in my mental arithmetic mode and looking at percentages here.
So I think it's about 8% of about 8% of people. 8%. You know, is it?
I'm not sure. I would know.
That's almost one. I mean, I guess that's.
It is quite a high number. I think obviously we've got to keep this under constant review. The review panels themselves will be looking at evidence and coming to conclusions. So it's really. You know, we need to see a kind of build-up of caseload and evidence to determine whether that's an issue about which to be concerned, and whether the. But you know, it's very much a product of the final decision making of Redress Scotland, which is of course carried out at arm's length from government.
Final questions,
I'm probably testing the committee's patience, but it's important to me. The other thing I wanted to follow on from was Stephanie Callaghan's question, because again, that's an issue I've come across in terms of people accessing statements and reports, and I get the sensitivity around it and fully appreciate the answer you've given. But I just wondered if it would be fair to say it wasn't the government's expectation at the time the bill passed that the restriction order would be in place. Is that fair?
I would prefer. If people were able to be able to use their the statements they've given to the inquiry.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mundell, and thank you very much, Deputy First Minister, for what's been a very helpful session. And I would like to thank everyone for their time today. And the public part of today's meeting is at an end, and we will consider our final agenda items in private. So thank you.